Folks, the 9/11 conspiracy theorists have presented some new nonsense that is easily debunkable, despite their best efforts to pretend reality isn't real. Before we get into the specifics, I want to make a bit of a blanket statement to help everyone who might have some questions about some things. If your question is,
well, how did this happen?
Consider the following. It didn't.
How did jet fuel melt perfect 90-degree lines in steel?
It didn't. Rescue teams and cleanup crews cut pieces of steel beams to remove them after the towers fell.
If a plane really hit the Pentagon, why didn't it hit any telephone poles?
Because the pilot didn't want to and made an effort to not do that. And if they did hit a pole, it didn't bring an entire airplane to a stop because physics?
Why did they find the wrong type of plane engine?
They didn't.
How did a pilot who could barely fly a Cessna dodge and weave a Boeing 767-200 through the New York skyline?
Oh, well, actually, let's go into some more details on that one. The pilots of Flight 11 and 175 both had private pilot certificates, instrument ratings, commercial pilot licenses, and had trained on a Boeing 727 and 767 simulator. That doesn't mean they were necessarily good at it, but it would be hard to argue that they could barely fly a Cessna. Were they bad at some point? Well, I would assume so, just like I would be bad at flying a Cessna with little to no experience, but I suspect that would change with several hundreds of hours of training. Next, here's an image of the New York skyline prior to the attacks in 2001. Notice how much taller the towers are than the buildings around them? If the planes hit them near the top, why would they then have to descend lower and pull up into the buildings? They didn't. They were descending as they approached, as is clearly visible in footage. And since we're talking about descent, there's this question about how the planes flew faster than what was possible for that type of aircraft. Just like the earlier questions, the answer is that they didn't. They exceeded the maximum speed the aircraft was certified to safely fly at. Flight 175, for example, was a Boeing 767-200, which has a VMO, or maximum operating velocity, of 360 knots at calibrated airspeed with a Mach number of 0.86. There was some concern that Flight 175 exceeded its VMO, reaching a speed estimated in some reports to be 587 miles per hour prior to impacting the South Tower. 360 knots is approximately 414 miles per hour, which, of course, is less than 587, but VMO is not the aircraft's top speed. Per 14 CFR 25.1505, the maximum operating limit speed, VMO, MMO, airspeed, or Mach number, whichever is critical at a particular altitude, is a speed that may not be deliberately exceeded in any regime of flight, climb, cruise, or descent, unless a higher speed is authorized for flight test or pilot training operations. Additionally, per this Boeing flight manual, sufficient thrust is available to exceed VMO in level flight at lower altitudes. Failure to reduce to cruise thrust in level flight can result in excessive airspeed. As well as overspeed, VMO, MMO, is the airplane maximum certified operating speed and should not be exceeded intentionally. However, crews can occasionally experience an inadvertent overspeed. Airplanes have been flight tested beyond VMO, MMO to ensure smooth pilot inputs will return the airplane safely to the normal flight envelope. So it clearly can be surpassed, it's just not permitted without permission. Between you and me, I don't think the terrorists were too concerned with permission. The actual maximum airspeed of a Boeing 767-200 is listed as 488 knots, or approximately 562 miles per hour. This is still slower than the fastest speed Flight 175 was calculated to be traveling at. So I'm going to give you a simple explanation, and then I'm going to give you a very complicated explanation. The simple explanation is this: that 562 miles per hour number is for a horizontal flight. Have you ever gone running and you encountered a downward slope and you were able to run faster because gravity is doing some of the work? Well, that's basically what's happening here. If we incorrectly assume the engines of a 767-200 can only get the plane to 562 miles per hour, then surely that speed could increase if the plane went into a dive because the engines are being assisted by gravity, and it would only need to increase 25 miles per hour. For comparison, there are humans that can run that fast. Not me, no. But other people, sure. The complicated explanation involves a bit of math, which means...
It's time for another math. Easy solution.
In this video here, we see a Boeing 767-200 take off in approximately 25 seconds from the Princess Juliana International Airport. The liftoff point appears to be here, which gives us an approximate distance of 1,000 meters. If we assume that the plane went 1,000 meters in 25 seconds, then we would want to know what the acceleration is. And to do that, we can use the equation acceleration equals 2 times distance divided by time squared, and we would get a result of 3.2 meters per second squared. If we assume that the weight of Flight 175 was 136 tons, as suggested in this paper by a professor of civil and environmental engineering at MIT, then the net force required to reach that acceleration would be calculated using the formula force equals mass times acceleration. The mass is 136 U.S. tons, or 123,377 kilograms. The acceleration is, once again, 3.2 meters per second squared, which gives us a force of 394,807 newtons. This is perfectly reasonable, as a 767-200 is capable of producing up to 498,000 newtons of thrust. However, if you're maintaining a constant speed without acceleration, you don't need any thrust at all. Remember Newton's first law? An object in motion stays in motion, with the same speed and in the same direction, unless acted upon by an unbalanced force. That's why the engines turn off when you reach cruising altitude. I'm kidding, of course. There is another force acting on the aircraft, air resistance. So, for the plane to maintain a constant speed, its thrust must equal its drag. But how do we determine drag? I hear it's the cheekbones. I hear that's what you determine drag through.
Pretty damn funny, right?
Sure, it's a laugh riot.
The drag coefficient for a Boeing 767-200 is 0.017. Assuming the aircraft is flying at 1,000 feet and the temperature around 9 a.m. on September 11, 2001 was 70 degrees, well, then the air density was 1.2 kilograms per cubic meter. The velocity squared would be 68,860.1 meters per second squared, and the reference area, well, at its widest, the nose has a diameter of 213 inches. I'm going to calculate it as a circle for simplicity, which only works against me by increasing the amount of drag. The area of a circle is 1 quarter pi diameter squared, so our diameter of 213 inches gives us an area of 35,632.73 inches squared, or approximately 23 square meters. The engine diameter is 9 feet 2 inches, or 110 inches. Once again, using the formula for an area of a circle, 1 quarter pi times 110 squared, is 9,503.3 square inches, or approximately 6 square meters. Because there are two engines, we double that number and get 12 square meters. The wingspan is 156 feet. However, we will remove 16 feet and 6 inches to account for the area that the nose is already taking up, which gives us 1,674 inches. A pixel analysis shows, at its thickest point, the wing can be estimated to be 141 inches tall. For the sake of simplicity in our calculations, we're going to assign a uniform height to the wings using the value of the thickest point. A width of 1,674 inches and a height of 141 inches gives us an area of 236,034 square inches, or 152.3 square meters. If you're concerned I'm using a thicker frontal area for the wing than would actually be present, don't forget, the larger the frontal area, the more drag will be created. Since I'm trying to show the engine can overcome the forces of drag while traveling at an airspeed of 587 miles per hour, more drag will only make it more difficult for me to do this. Using more pixel analysis, I've estimated the vertical stabilizer to be approximately 103.5 by 693.25 inches, which gives us an area of 71,751.4 square inches, or 46.3 square meters. The horizontal stabilizers are each 47 by 450.5 inches, which gives us an area of 25,403.5 square inches, or 16.4 square meters. Since there are two of them, we'll double that and get 32.8 square meters. In total, the front reference area would be 23 plus 12 plus 152.3 plus 46.3 plus 32.8 square meters, which equals 266.4 square meters. When we plug that into our calculations for drag, we get 191,075 newtons of drag from a plane that can produce 498,000 newtons of thrust. If I have this correct, a 767-200 would only need to operate at 38.4% power to maintain this supposedly impossible speed of 587 miles per hour. And if I don't have this correct, I still have 306,925 newtons of wiggle room. So if these planes can go faster, why don't they? Well, if you run the engine at full power for the entire flight, a few things might happen. You might generate too much heat in the engine over time, maneuvering and turbulence will cause much more stress to the aircraft, and you're going to burn a lot more fuel. If you thought putting gas in your car was expensive, oh boy. Also, it might end up violating EPA emission laws, but that's a different conversation. There is another reason commercial planes don't just full throttle it. Earlier, I mentioned a Mach number, specifically 0.86. This is a number you do not want to exceed, although you certainly could if you weren't too concerned with living. A Mach speed of 0.86 means if you reach that airspeed, the flow of air over your wings will become supersonic. If your plane is not designed to handle repeated sonic booms on the top of its wings, which the 767-200 isn't, the structural integrity of your plane is going to suffer. Also, you have to deal with something called Mach tuck, where the plane enters a potentially unrecoverable dive due to the front of your wing being blasted downward by sonic explosions, while the rear of your wing continues to happily generate lift.
Meow.
Mach 0.86 is 659.9 miles per hour. That is well above the speed Flight 175 was estimated to be traveling. Well, it's well above the airspeed. See, ground speed and airspeed aren't the same thing. Ground speed is the speed an aircraft is going relative to the ground. Airspeed is the speed an aircraft is going relative to the air. For example, if I was in a Cessna with an airspeed of 60 knots facing into the wind, which was blowing directly towards me at 60 knots, then in theory my ground speed would be zero, even though my airspeed would be about 60 knots. I'd be essentially hovering in place. However, I would still be able to go up and down by changing the speed at which air is flowing over my wings. The faster the air flows over the top, the more lift is generated. If you are generating lift, that means the airflow over the wing is faster than the airspeed of the plane. So, to truly know if Flight 175's airspeed was less than its Mach speed, we need to know the direction and speed of the wind. Around the time Flight 175 struck the South Tower, the wind direction was north, based on this hourly wind direction chart. This appears to be consistent with images of the smoke from the North Tower. The wind speed was less than 3.5 miles per hour. If we assume Flight 175's ground speed was in fact 587 miles per hour, and it was flying into a headwind of 3.5 miles per hour, then its airspeed would be 590.5 miles per hour. This is still well below the Mach speed. So, was it possible for an aircraft that only needs an estimated 38.4% of its engine power to maintain a level speed of 587 miles per hour at 1,000 feet to then sustain that speed while losing altitude in a 114 mile per hour descent without shaking apart? Yes. Not only do we know this because of math, which I get it, this is literal rocket science. If you believed that the planes were holograms, you were not going to get this. We also know it because it happened. We saw it. This isn't a hologram. It isn't a missile. It was a plane with human lives on board that you spit on with your ignorance. The anonymous they could create a full hologram of a plane and a cold-directed energy weapon, but they couldn't get the plane speed right? Grow up. And to bring this full circle, yes, flying at those speeds would have made it difficult to maneuver. Good thing they weren't dodging between buildings, but were in fact intentionally aiming for the tallest thing in the area while approaching from above them. I really appreciate you making it to the end of this. This video isn't monetized, so if you want to support my research and educational productions, liking, commenting, and/or subscribing is a fantastic way to do that. Until the next time, ladies and gentlemen, be good. Stay safe.